Edmund is a game where the core gameplay mechanic is rape. It's not a theme that's explored loosely, nor is it an idea that's toyed with. It's the very subject and foundation of the game. This is why many people find it rather hard to sit through it after they discover this fact. Let alone finish the game when they discover this. However, the rape isn't done ham-fistedly, nor is it done for shock value. The game's attempting to make a point, and it does so very well. I admit, I was a little hesitant to stick with Edmund after the initial rape scene, but I'm glad I did. I came to terms with three very important things Edmund was doing. The first, quite simply, was to show the atrocities of rape, and it did so better than any other medium I've ever experienced, by forcing me to actually take part in the action. It was jarring, unsettling, and horrific, which is why it was so damn effective. To know that it was actually my actions causing the atrocities on screen was rather shocking, to say the least, and it made me see rape as an instrument of fear rather than a plot device or generic bad action, as many movies and books have done. That was the first thing this independent 8-bit game did. It made me afraid of rape. The second thing Edmund does is it challenges our morals. Now, a common critique of moral choices in games is that they're too extreme. You can either help this man with his quest or stab him in the face. No, the reason Edmund challenges my morals better than I think any other console game has ever challenged my morals is because it's not challenging my own personal morals, or yours for that matter. I'm assuming most of you are against rape. No, Edmund is challenging our morals as gamers, or more accurately, our tenacity as gamers. You see, when I pushed the button and I found I was raping the girl, I was offended, I was shocked, I felt like I had been insulted as a human being and my mortal coil was being torn apart with every passing second. However, I couldn't stop, because the game told me to, because to see the ending of the game, I had to continue. And it was quite interesting, or at least quite worrying, that I was willing to put this, albeit fictional, character through absolute hell because the game told me to, because I wanted to see the ending of the game. The thing is, though, the game didn't tell me to, and I didn't have to rape her to see the ending of the game. After all, this is a game about moral choices, and one of the first choices you're given is to just get in the car and drive away. Now, I admit, it's not a flashy ending, but it's an ending all the same. But, for some reason, this wasn't satisfying to me. And I think it's because, simply, there was more there. Because there was more to the game than simply getting in the car and driving away, I felt like I had to do it. Because the game was telling me, hey, you haven't seen me all the way through, hey, there are things that you could do. I felt that I needed to do them. It was then that I realised that my morals take a back seat during gaming, simply because the game presents me with the option to put them there. I was perfectly fine with committing unforgivable acts if it means I get to win, if it means I get the full game experience, no matter how terrible that experience is, if it means I get the full experience, I'm willing to do it, which is rather unnerving. Either that or I'm just a closet rapist, which I'm not going to talk about in this video. This is true interactive storytelling. This is interactive storytelling at its finest. It's willing to make me disgusted with myself to do things that I never thought I would even be able to make a fictional character do for the sole purpose of the story and seeing where it goes. Now, the game brings me back to what it means to be a true video game geek. I was talking to my friend about some RPG, Enchanted Arms, I think it was, and he had 80 hours playtime, and he had just beaten it, and I asked him if he liked it, and he said, no, it was terrible, it was like injecting crack into my eyes, except it wasn't crack, it was bleach and on fire, and he had nothing good to say about the game, but he still had 80 hours of playtime, because he was a geek, and because he wanted to see the ending of the game. Now, Edmund was able to put me through all of that torture in a fraction of the time, and still get the same end result, which is why the man deserves his award. The final thing Edmund really did for me was it highlighted this hilarious double standard we apparently have in video games. Like, I went on a forum where they were talking about the game, and there were comments that were literally like, this is the worst game ever made, this person is absolutely awful, he deserves to die, they should throw him in prison, this is the single worst thing to happen since the Holocaust, anger, anger, la 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 la, rage. However, one of the people to make these comments had one of those little now playing things in their signature, and one of the games he was playing was Modern Warfare 2, a game which shamelessly has you murdering civilians, and you know, I'm not going to get into this because, you know, artistic value and all that, but still, it's a game where you gun down civilians in an airport, but when rape is brought up, no, that's abysmal, that's atrocious, how dare he? So, my question is, why are we willing to spend hundreds and hundreds of pounds or dollars or whatever on games where you murder people in the most horrific ways? Some games where you actually torture people, but rape is completely and utterly out of the question and wrong in every single scenario. What is it about rape that makes it so much worse than the other two actions? Why can we play a Grand Theft Auto game where we can, and I don't know if you can actually do this in Grand Theft Auto, this is just an example, where you can shoot off a guy's limbs one by one and it literally takes him minutes and minutes to die, but rape is completely wrong in every single scenario? Or not wrong, but worse. Why is rape worse than that? So, Edmund makes three poignant and very unignorable statements. The horrible double standards we have as gamers, the atrocious nature of rape as a whole, and why we're willing to go through with it just because the game asks us to. Going back to that last point for a minute, the Revran over on Destructoid about Edmund said that he didn't know he was going to rape the girl, and that it was an accident, and indeed Sonny did the same thing when I asked him to play through it and get me some videos. But the thing is, after they figured out what they were doing, they still went through with the action. Now, I haven't played a console game this year, or indeed the last few years, that have raised this many questions and made me actually question my own morals in a game. In fact, I think this is the first ever to do that. So, a lot of people are asking, isn't Edmund crude? Isn't it violent? Isn't it disgusting? Well, yes it is, but it's also making a very delicate and very important point, in the same way that I Stand Alone was violent and awful to watch, but made an incredible point, and was a great case study, really. Edmund accomplishes so much using so little, and the idea that so many people are simply writing it off because of the grisly subject matter is, well, it's downright unfortunate is what it is. I contacted Paul Grizzly for a brief interview about the game, which I'm sure I'll post somewhere. Just keep checking the YouTube description. For now, I'll leave you with a few choice quotes. On the subject of double standards in games, Greasy said, "There's not much to say about this, as the only reason the game is broken outside the indie development circle is because of the rape. A good example is no one has sent me a nasty email about the opening scene in Vietnam, where you could wildly shoot down innocents with a chopper-heavy machine gun, because violence is cool, isn't it?" On the subject of programming the game, Greasy said that, "Building the game was difficult. The uneasy feelings I got making the game were largely overshadowed by trying to deliver the story. For the record, I made the game to stretch myself as a game developer." Finally, Greasy leaves with, "I don't think there's any hidden secrets here. It's about a wartime veteran dealing with the horrors from his past. I don't think I walked into this with a message in mind, but to tell a story about a man named Michael dealing with the horrors he faced during the war, and their effects on him sometime later. The mental struggle he undertakes nightly from allowing Edmund to take over consciousness. A mental struggle between good and evil."